evening. I'm so glad you could make church tonight.
Good evening.
Very formal start to a very informal experience. I like the air conditioning, I'm not going to lie. So dragging all of this stuff out to there, I don't know. All those in favor of just sitting in the air conditioning for the summer, say aye.
Aye.
All those who want to go outside and sweat and tear things out, say aye.
I'm the only one that
voted.
The
ice cap. You gotta come early and drag it from the house. You're dragging things out. It's on you. Can't just throw you in the bus like you would believe. I'm so glad you're here today. I love something. It's so I ask if you would to open up your bulletins to the quiet meditation. It's printed inside. Today's quiet meditation comes from Lawrence E. Mick. And I always was fascinated by the word hospitality, especially since it's also in the same root as hospital. I say that because for a hospital, that's the place where when we're wounded, or we're sick, or we're unsure, we go for some kind of help that our bodies need to be knitted back together. We have an injury, we have something that is less than our wholeness there. And I think that's important because hospitality in of itself can sometimes just mean, yeah, come on in. But I think it's more than that. I think hospitality says to us that maybe when someone comes to see us, they do have something missing. They have something missing in our hearts, or your souls, when you come together, we really need it one another. It's our very existence, the very center of who we are and what we are about as Christians, that says that the Son within me, that by which God has given me, I give away to others. And that, I think, is exactly what Lawrence is saying here. He writes, hospitality is more than fixing meals. It requires opening our hearts to notice to me. And so often on the holidays, like 4th of July, Labor Day, any over the summer, we invite people over for picnics and celebrations. We think of hot dogs, which are, you know, nobody wants to know how you make a hot dog, there's no meat on. And marshmallows, we're not really sure what's in marshmallows when they taste good. The same thing is true. People come to us and we don't know exactly what it is that their needs are. Love them, or compassion for them. And so this week I ask that we pause and pray during our quiet meditation and that the hospitality that we have experienced and that we have to offer to one another, and may we knit together, bandage up, recognize and engage in what it means to be incomplete for another, so that we can whole together as community in relationship with one another, and as community in relationship with God. Would you please turn again your bulletins to the call to worship that's printed there? It begins with this. O God, grant that we may revere and love your holy name.
We never deprive of your guidance.
Those who sit firm on your foundation of love,
through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you
in the unity of the Holy Spirit,
God forever and ever. Amen.
And so our first hymn is a miracle. Okay. I think you have time to do that job.
No.
You have
that job.
So it's 697. So if you want to turn to 697. Oh, if you would please rise as you're able.
Thank you.
playing the Jackie Chan. Tonight's responsive greeting, so most of our responsive greetings usually come from the Psalms, but tonight's responsive greeting comes from the Gospel of St. Luke, and it is the Magnificat. So these are the words that Mary spoke, a poem, if you will, a celebration and humility, when God said to her that you have been called to carry my son, to carry the Messiah, to bring forth the person by which you will understand God, as I will be manifest, I will be created in human form. And so with great humility, Mary says these words, "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. From this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has filled the rich with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty.
He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever."
And as we pause and reflect on the words of Luke, I ask if we can imagine what it would have been like to be a Roman in Jerusalem, a centurion, a leader, someone who was not Jesus or Jewish, to hear those words, to imagine their reaction, that the hungry fed, and the rich sent away. I ask if you turn the page to today's opening prayer, and join with me in saying, God, you formed us out of your love. Breathe new life in faith into our living. Lead us to life eternal by the mighty love of Jesus Christ. Fill your disciples with strength, vision, and confidence. Bring upon us now a sense of your life-giving spirit. Amen. Today's first scripture reading comes from the book of Genesis, the very first book of the Bible. It's also part of the Torah, the first five books. And it's chapter 18, verses 1 through 8. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the Terebinth of Mamre, as Abraham sat in the entrance of his tent while the day was growing hot, like right now. Looking up, he saw three men standing nearby. When he saw them, he ran from the entrance of the tent to greet them. And bowing to the ground, he said, "Sir, if I may ask you this favor, please do not go on past your servant. Let some water be brought that you may bathe your feet and then rest yourselves under the tree. Now that you have come this close to your servant, let me bring you a little food that you may refresh yourselves and afterward you may go on your way." And the men replied, "Very well, do as you have said." Abraham hastened into the tent and told Sarah, "Quick, three measures of fine flour, knead it and make rolls." He ran to the herd, picked out a tender, choice steer, and gave it to the servants who quickly prepared it. Then Abraham got some curds and milk, as well as the steer that had been prepared, and set these before them. And he waited on them under the tree while they would you please stand as you are able and join me in the morning prayer?
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Would you please remain standing as you are able and join me in the Gospel reading? It comes from St. Matthew, chapter 8, it's verses 5 to 13. When Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion approached him and appealed to him, saying, "Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed, suffering dreadfully. He said to him, I will come and cure him. And the centurion said to him, Lord, I am not worthy to have you enter under my roof. Only say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I too am a man subject to authority, with soldiers subject to me. And I say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come here, and he comes, and to my slave, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard this, he was amazed, and said to those following him, Amen, I say to you, in no one in Israel have I found such faith. I say to you, many will come from the east and the west, and will recline with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob at the banquet in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom will be driven out into the outer darkness, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. And Jesus said to the centurion, You may go. As you believe, let it be done for you. And at that very hour, the servant was healed. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Would you please be seated? Would you please join with me in prayer? May the words of our lips and the meditations of our hearts be always acceptable to you, O Lord. Jesus is amazed because in this story, and you feel as if you are alone and broken and damaged and ruined and wounded, Jesus Christ is for you. And if you carry on a life with Christ, you are transformed. In today's gospel, we learn that in the Greek, right, the centurion does not use the term slave. It's interpreted that way. But it is not actually that. Instead, he calls his son. And so there's two ways of looking at that. One way, from some of the research I did just a few days ago, is that there's a possibility that the centurion had this quote-unquote slave in a relationship that it was not acceptable. In other words, he had a lover or a girlfriend who was Jewish, and that was taboo. And so he comes to Jesus in humility. He's humiliated by the fact that for all his strength and all his power, he has this child, and he can't do anything for it. He grieves his child's suffering and loss. And in faith comes to Christ. Blessed are the peacemakers. We learn in the Gospel of St. Luke that the same centurion has built the synagogue for the Jews. Now the Jews and the Romans did not get along. Yet this centurion, he was living out the absolute Sermon on the Mount. He was humble. He was a peacemaker. He grieved. He was meek. And I say that meek. Romans, he couldn't have to go and ask Jesus for help. He could have went to Jesus and grabbed him by the scruff of his shirt and dragged him to his house and demanded that he help his child. He came to him as meek. He had the choice to live life in one way. And again, but I think that Jesus is amazed at how often the people that he calls in to be, calls in and expects to be the chosen people, refuse to hear the message. There's an awkwardness in people who aren't quote unquote Christians, or have a heck of a lot more Christian than I. We have these moments where I see people demonstrate the very fiber and foundation of the Christian faith. Amazed at both their faith and their courage and their strength, and amazed by my own weakness, my own lack of faith, my own lack of sense of absolutely standing where I should always be. And so every day, we have a choice. Every day, we have a choice to amaze God. We can amaze God like the people of Nazareth and kind of like go through the motions and think, I go to church, I must be going to heaven. We can amaze God like the centurion who, against all expectations, does all the things God has called him to do. And Genesis, he hear the message, the story of Abraham. Abraham preceded, because Genesis comes before Exodus, Moses and the Ten Commandments. Abraham precedes all the rules and regulations of Leviticus that tells you what you should and shouldn't do, what you can and cannot do, what food is good and what food is forbidden. Abraham precedes all of the regulations and the delineation, like the setting up of how you are supposed to be Jewish based on your tribe, and says to him, this is why you are the chosen people. Every single time, every single thing that we equate with our faith when it comes to law, when it comes to rules, comes after Abraham knows better because of his relationship with God. Abraham chose each and every one of us. Well, it's like to say, I don't know who that stranger is, but I'm going to feed them, I'm going to wash them, and I'm going to give them something to drink. I'm going to love them the way I think God wants me to love. God, this is Abraham, draws him out into the dark evening, and it was, you didn't come out that dark, just so you know. Points out to the sky and says, see those stars? Your nation will number more than this. You know your old, you know Sally's, you know everything's past what it should be. Your reverence, your hospitality, is honored and esteemed. So, Abraham, praise your God. And so whether it's Hebrew scripture or the Old Testament, as you read it, or the Gospel of the New Testament, the 21st century, it says this one. We are called to meet God. With our meekness, with our justice, with our love, with our grief, with our lives with one another. May we have that strong relationship with God. We know how we are called to act, not only in reverence to God, but in honor and dignity of the world. Each time we come together, we pause for prayer. That's a sharing of celebrations and consent. Pray for the crops. The right combination of rain and sun, so that when do you kick off for the sand?
Probably not until near the end of July.
End of July. Mm-hmm. I got today this morning. Full off greens. That's fine, right?
That's right. Yes.
Yeah, I'm learning. Learning.
I'll
pull this up. as always, grateful that we have an opportunity to come together to worship, to praise, to reverence, and serve. We lift up in our hearts this day those prayers too difficult for even us to speak. Yet in those prayers, we do hear and we answer. Today, there are prayers that we do have the strength and the courage to put upon our lips and to share the ears of our beloved community. Our Lord God, we pray for our nation as we celebrate our independence. In addition, God, we pray for our military and veterans, great gratitude for all that we have. We lift them up in safety. This day we lift up Neil as he continues to receive medical help and services. We lift up Jean's sister as she continues to travel the United States. We lift up this day everybody in our country as they celebrate this holiday. Sometimes we are a little reckless during these seasons. Guide us all to safety and protection, thoughtfulness, and maybe a little bit of support. Lord, we lift up this day our farmers who feed us and nourish us. The crops come in healthy and strong in the midst of a difficult weather season. Lord, we are grateful we can come to you. We are grateful that you hear us and that your presence is known to us now and always. Amen. This time we will celebrate Holy Communion. I ask if you would, could you open up your hymnals to page 12? And follow along. You trust me that my hands are washed. Right, I forgot to bring it. That's why I got it. I don't know what it's called. It's it. Used for a long time. Oh. That's it, broke through. It was like, shh. Christ our Lord invites you to save all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and to one another. Merciful God,
we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart.
We have failed to be an obedient church.
We have not done your will.
We have broken your law.
We have rebelled against your love.
We have not loved our neighbors.
We have not heard the cry of the need.
Forgive us, we pray.
Free us for joyful obedience.
Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen.
Turning now to page 13, please join me. Sorry. In the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, and creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord,
God of power and might,
heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of the suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. This is a little coffin fit, I think. the night in which you gave yourself up for us, you took bread, you gave thanks, you broke it, you gave it to your disciples and said, take, eat all of you. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this as often as you come together in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, you took the cup and gave thanks. You gave it to your disciples and said, take, drink all of you. This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you come together in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on this gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make to be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, in one ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast in his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. All are welcome at this table. So we have a simple serve. Able, and join me in our final hymn. It's number 431. Let there be peace on earth. On earth. 431. Thank you. want mercy. Want love. Want wholeness. Want transformation. Let us look on the world in the same way as the centurion. Let us take our hearts to Christ and say, please, O God, fix us and our world. I know that this takes courage, strength, and bravery. And I pray that you trust these words, that God loves you, and so do I. And that you go in peace this day, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.